Yo, Tanse.
Bonsoir.
Nobody out here is answering me. Sego. Teach you a Mohawk word to start. Greetings to all of you. It is surely clear from this event and this audience that something historic is going on. Even the words I've heard thus far, and that reconciliation is growing beyond being a nice word. What a privilege it is to participate with you in this 60th anniversary convocation event. Thanks first, Nyamagoa, to the powerful drums whose heartbeat welcomed us and united us. The fact that you are here tonight is itself a dream come true and a harbinger of reconciliation. Thanks also for acknowledging that it is our custom, our protocol, our requirement as Indigenous peoples to frequently remind ourselves about the earth on which we walk and about the land on which we are situated. And so I start by asking that we acknowledge those who have gone before us, those who were here before us in this land's long history, and that we think of them, and that we thank them for the honor and privilege of meeting on their land. This evening is an opportunity for all of us to get revitalized, to get redirected and recommitted to meet the challenges before us if we are to end Canada's mixed achievement and failure in its relationships with Indigenous peoples and get ourselves started on a good path for the next 150 years. This time around, this beginning of the next 150 years, we do not have to accept a future shaped by the rigid mold of settler circumstance and colonial custom. For the next 150 years, we don't have to carry the burden of Canada's evolution from being subjects of its own colonial past into its present role of being colonizers in its own right, colonizing Indigenous peoples. We can put an end to Canada's addiction to colonialism, its reluctance to shake that habit, and an end to promising that it will quit doing that and do better. An end to stumbling from one set of problems, we read about it in the press every day, and promises to the next, then failing to keep those promises, and the cycle repeats. The Indigenous people of Australia refer to promises of that kind as gesture politics. I love that term. For the next 150 years, we Indigenous people are looking forward to change. For the last 150, we have fought major efforts to keep from becoming former Indigenous persons. Rather, this time around, Canadians have an opportunity to become former colonizers. And together, we can create our shared future by design. In fact, we can dream together and can make our dream come true. That's really exciting to think about. Well, that's what I want to talk about this evening, reminding us individually and collectively that we have the power and the strength to design solutions and to implement them. The power to make reconciliation between Canadians generally and Indigenous peoples happen in our time. I also want to remind us that if we don't do it, if we don't fulfill our duty to make reconciliation happen, it isn't going to happen. It would be very helpful, I think, as we begin our task of reconciliation, if Indigenous people could have a positive answer from Canada that it truly wants to have a Canada which includes sustainable Indigenous communities. If we get agreement on that objective, we can concentrate on making that outcome possible. Why do we need that reassurance? Why do we need a jointly agreed upon outcome? Well, the facts are, folks, that from the beginning, the Canada of 1867 had very firm views of who was and wasn't going to form the population of this country. Canada was to become exclusively for the settlers' own home and native land. Sir John A. Macdonald put it nearly 150 years ago this way. Providence has been pleased to provide us with one nation, unbroken from sea to sea, to be peopled by one people with one common heritage and a common religion. He wasn't talking about Mohawks. In other words, the new Canada would be an Indigenous-free Canada, a Canada free of anyone else who was different from first British and later British and French settler status quo. There was a Dominion Lands Act passed which legalized the taking of Indigenous lands, Indigenous resources in Western Canada without any compensation whatsoever. An injustice sustained by legal mythology and artifice and which lives on unmentioned still today, with little effort to even discuss the matter, much less to rectify the injustices. In the Canada of 1867, Indigenous peoples would be relegated to reserves and, where necessary, moved away from white settlements. Laws would be passed that all Indians, as we were called then, had to be out of town before sunset. Indigenous people would, by law, be excluded from the Canadian economy. An Indigenous farmer had to have a permit from an Indian agent to sell a bushel of carrots. The first Indian Act passed by the Dominion in 1867 was titled An Act for the Gradual Civilization of the Indians. Real, true, our history. By law, we were made wards of the state, regarded as incompetent to make our own decisions. The Indian Act gave legal authority to the government to take over management of our affairs and deny us our rights in the process. Later, our ceremonies would be banned by law. In fact, the then Prime Minister called them debauchery of the worst kind. Prime Minister, our people were imprisoned for dancing our traditional dances. An Indian was to have a permit to be outside the reserve at all, and we were by law declared to be non-persons. The Indian Act says, a person is an individual other than an Indian. Any Indian who obtained a post-secondary degree was asked to sign away their rights as an Indian. No no surprise, we didn't have a lot of post-secondary graduates. We were in fact prohibited from obtaining a lawyer to protect our rights and interests in land. So First Nations were kind of to be swept aside with the broom of progress, uncivilized chaff who didn't quite fit into a nation of British and French settlers. That's the same Indian Act as amended, which remains the law of the land today. And the unfortunate truth must be understood. Education was to become a principal means of making all that happen. As Commissioner Murray Sinclair, now Senator Sinclair, said for the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, education is what got us into this mess. The use of education is what is going to get us out of it. He was referring in his report to the many generations of our people who went to residential school. And I guess the closest one to here would be the Mushmole in Brantford, I think, not far from where I live. So the residential schools, and that closed, by the way, 69, I think. The last residential school closed in Canada in the mid-90s. So in the residential schools, our children would be taken away and taught the Canadian way, which meant to adhere to British values, religions, forbidden to speak our language, taught their place in the new Canada. This was necessary, Prime Minister Macdonald told Parliament in 1879, because, and he said, when the school's on the reserve, the child lives with its parents, who are savages. And though he may learn to read and write, his habits and training mode of thought are Indian. He is simply a savage who can read and write, end quote. Well, that sentiment was renewed 9 decades later with the 60s scoop in our lifetimes. Not some distant past, tens of thousands of Indigenous children were removed from their parents so that they could be given a good home with non-Indigenous parents, often in the United States and even in Europe. And yes, money did exchange hands in some instances. Many of these young people, not young now, but are still today trying to reunite with their parents and their brothers and sisters. This residential schools and 60s school set into motion an intergenerational legacy which has not yet run out. Adults who didn't know what it means to be raised up in a family, how could you know? People who never knew what parents were supposed to do, who never experienced being parented, who never acquired those skills. Students who became adults who fear showing emotion. People who lost their language, lost the ability to communicate with their grandparents, often lost their pride, their confidence in themselves. Children and youth taught to turn against their culture, taught to hate themselves and their people. I think about these things today when I see our children and youth, and I admire the resilience that they have against all odds. We are still here. I think of them when I hear about suicide epidemics, incarceration rates, children in care. You read about these things. Murdered and missing Indigenous women. It's not by accident that these things happen. And that sad situation is unlikely to change until we have as our reality something which, for our children and youth, they didn't have. an opportunity for schooling which includes our history, our languages, our values, our science, an opportunity to reaffirm our identity, to demonstrate then that we have a future in Canada and that we're prepared to make it happen. My vision is for an education in which all of us, but particularly our children and youth, are encouraged and empowered to hold on to their cultural values, to find good people to shape their lives around, to discover ways to be fully involved in everything that is happening in our communities, in the broader society, in the country, and in the world. I want us to have that kind of education so we can make a difference in our own lives, and so we can make a difference in the lives of others. I would even go further than Senator Murray Sinclair. He said, education created this mess, education's going to get us out of it. I would add that there are three kinds of education which must happen if reconciliation is going to happen. First, education of Canadians about the truth of what they found when they first arrived on Turtle Island. So that includes education about the democracy happening here, which was at that time unknown in Europe. That's why people came over here for fairer treatment by government. They found democracy amongst the Haudenosaunee people. The scientific knowledge that existed at that time, in medicine, in botany, astronomy, law, conflict resolution, sustainable agriculture, all those things existed, and that too is Canadian history. That's number one. The second kind of education we need is a true history of what happened between us. Both are offering to share and making a decision, conscious decision, when we were the majority, to share our lands and resources. Our offers that were codified in the Two Row Wampum, our offers of consent to enter into treaty relationships, our offers of peace and friendship, our fierce and unremitting defense of the Crown, which made the difference of whether Waterloo today is a Canadian university or an American one. Did you know that? Canadians really need to know what happened in our history, and especially all that has happened since 1867, the 150th anniversary of a relationship which has caused Indigenous peoples pretty incredible damage. That education is not only about what has happened to us in our history, it's also a part of the history all Canadians should know. So they'll understand why there is a need for reconciliation, and understand what is needed if reconciliation is to happen. It's the universities of Canada who, with all respect for academic freedom, must provide the teachers, the administrators, the historians with the unexpurgated truths which Canadians have the right to know. The university itself, I suggest, must take the steps necessary so that graduating students understand the history and legacy of the colonial enterprise. Every student who walks across that stage during convocation should know the history of the 150 years of entrenched, embedded racism, the deliberate destruction of family and cultural ties, the unjust appropriation of lands and resources. And graduates should become conscious and should understand in their heart the fact that collective passivity, particularly political passivity, has been a crucial element in maintaining the status quo, lo these many years. I say this not to put people in a situation where they feel guilty, or worse, have a kind of what people have described an emotional bankruptcy or a moral bankruptcy. This will not help us, any of us. We need to understand our shared history so that we can move forward together. I think universities, and you've noted it earlier, will have failed in their development of professionals unless professional practice includes taking personal responsibility to engage in a bilateral reconciliation process. And that means engaging in reconciliation means an upfront acceptance of the fact that universities, and you said it earlier, have been very much a part, an instrument of, and a beneficiary of Canada's colonization of Indigenous peoples and our lands and resources. So I urge that your efforts here, especially on this momentous occasion of the 60th anniversary, contains a commitment to decolonize the university. Dr. David Barnard, who was the chair of Universities Canada and was the president and vice chancellor of the University of Manitoba, has put it, he said, in 2011, before the TRC, decolonization is the only way that Indigenous knowledge, perspectives, and worldviews will be integrated into curricula, programs, and services, the only way there will be consciousness raising and a provision of relevant training for those teaching and interacting with students. As well, he urges speaking out. He said, when we see wrongs and untruths, we must fight against them. Where there are people facing social injustices, we must stand up for them. And where there is racism, we must challenge it. That's Dr. David Barnard. Tremendous leadership. So that's the second area. The third kind of education is something Indigenous peoples have to do for ourselves. But we need, absolutely need support and assistance to do it. And that is the education of our own Indigenous children about how to be Indigenous people today in contemporary society in all aspects of their lives as Indigenous people. The way our children are raised with our cultures, to understand the worldview that our values provide, the Indigenous approach to science, justice, conflict resolution, maintaining peace, those things remain in our communities. We need to nurture them, teach them, validate the identity our young people have. Because as young kids, I see a lot of people say, you know, oh, these young kids, they don't have great self-esteem and so on. You know, poor them, we need to give them self-confidence. I say self-confidence, you need to give them validation. Validation for who they are, that they are worthy, they are rich, they are talented, they hold promise for this country. That's what they need. They need to see themselves in the textbook, on the TV, in the front of the stage, in the boardroom, in the parliament, everywhere. Validation. That's what they need. As Indigenous people. So that kind of education is a dream I'm asking you to help come true. parents didn't have, given the history I've explained, a schooling that teaches protocols, how to conduct ourselves as good human beings, an indigenous person, a parent, an elder, validation, so that we can realize our absolutely fullest potential. I wonder if you would personally want to help create that reality. There's room for everyone to play a role. I wonder if you and your colleagues would agree to accept that challenge and start by talking about how you might do that in the coffee period after. These three kinds of education are needed if we're going to have reconciliation, because reconciliation is not a noun. Reconciliation is not an event. It's not a report. It's a verb. It requires constant action, daily maintenance, initiative, perseverance over time, a state of mind that we are going to make it happen. You and I, all of us together, participants in reconciliation, each of us needs education, maybe training, to take reconciliatory actions, learning, giving, sharing, empowering, planning, acting, developing alliances, engaging in healing, engaging in nation building. We must all become workers in the reconstruction. And that's the reconstruction we need if we're going to have reconciliation. It's not by chance that my friends say, not reconciliation, reconciliation. That's what we need. I think we're not going to have a better future for ourselves and for our children, for our country for that matter. We are the fastest growing demographic group, unless we make changes now, in the present. We have to demonstrate that we're living in a relationship in which we value each other, a relationship which demonstrates that Canada wants to be a country with a sustainable future that includes Indigenous peoples. We must demonstrate eager to start making real, tangible changes now. And I am thrilled to see that is starting to happen. Across Canada, there are already pretty remarkable things happening in schools, in universities, in workplaces. I'm hearing about grade schools that are opening their morning's exercises, acknowledging the traditional territory that their school is located on. I had a parent come up to me the other night and say, I'm so thrilled, my 11-year-old daughter came home from school, she's doing a project on reconciliation, boy did she teach me a lot. I'm seeing some great changes. The corporate sector is moving ahead rapidly. They're taking very seriously, of course they must, but they're taking very seriously the law set out in Supreme Court decisions and finding it's good for business to do it. It benefits all of us. There is a new wind of hope in the air. I have never been as optimistic as I am today, and I grew up with an Indian agent in my community. Under the Indian Act, I know what it's like. I've never been so optimistic about the emerging potential, especially to achieve reconciliation through education. Efforts are also being made to increase political will, hooray, and then to demand that political will be demonstrated, to hold governments accountable for living up to their commitments and their promises. All of this is helping inspire the national charity of which I have the honor of being the president and CEO. Our efforts to raise funds for bursaries for Indigenous post-secondary studies are producing better results. 93% of the students we support graduate. We had a boost, yeah, it's a great number. And we just got a boost in the last federal budget. Thank you, Mr. Trudeau. There is also greater support to increase the high school graduation rate of our students. Right now, 4 out of 10 of our kids successfully graduate from high school versus almost 9 out of 10 other Canadian kids. Huge gap. We're working with educators, we're coaching teachers, we're sharing best practices to improve those outcomes and to produce more graduates. We are proud to be working with the UCC, the Universities and Colleges of Canada, on numerous initiatives. And we're finding greater support from governments, the corporate sector, philanthropists, and individuals who are discovering that it is a comfortable myth we tell ourselves in Canada that all Indigenous students receive funding support from cradle to grave for all the education they ever want, don't they? Not. People are becoming to learn that that is a myth. We are also seeing many other activities across the country, too numerous to mention. And Waterloo is an excellent example of how education is going to make reconciliation happen. This region is known for innovation, right? Well, here you go. This is a great way to apply your innovation focus. The kind of social innovation we need, new thinking, out of the box. The co-sponsor of this event, I know the Waterloo Aboriginal Education Center at St. Paul's, is facilitating the sharing of Indigenous knowledge, the Circle of Lifelong Learning, the Indigenous Advisory Circle, a summer camp for Indigenous girls, a program of Indigenous government and community involvement. Your Aboriginal Students Association is alive and engaged. When I was at university, there were 4 of us. Your Water Institute is engaging with Indigenous communities, and you have an Indigenous speaker series, innovations which would be unthought of just a decade or 2 ago. And you're just getting started, right? Another example of this kind of reconciliation action took place in January of this year, when a University of Toronto committee released a 125-page report with 34 recommendations in response to the 2015 calls to action by the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. They grouped them in 6 categories: Indigenous spaces, Indigenous faculty and staff, Indigenous curriculum, Indigenous research ethics, critical, and community relationships, Indigenous students, co-curricular education, and 6, institutional leadership and implementation. That report I commended to you, it is an example of reconciliation with resonance, which Waterloo is quite capable of surpassing. Your setting is ideal to spark action. Look where you are on the original tract. You can spark, the tract, the Six Nations original tract. You're smack here. You're not far from the grant. You can get your inspiration there as I do. Spark action, create synergy, awaken alumni, and bring about change internally and externally. You can have an exponential effect as students, faculty, alumni get excited about what it is they can do to make reconciliation a reality. What a wonderful way to celebrate your 60th anniversary. In 2017, I believe Canadians want to see change. I believe Canadians really want reconciliation. I believe Canadians want to see a positive future for Indigenous peoples. And they want to see a Canada that includes Indigenous peoples. Canadians want to see changes that change people's lives. Changes that make them proud to be Canadians in the 21st century. And education will fit that bill and make reconciliation happen. I think we can achieve the exciting and amazing promise that awaits us. We can create our shared future by design. We can dream together, as I said at the outset, and make our dreams come true. And it is exciting. Achieving success, for me, is not a choice. It's a duty. And we owe it, I believe, to our great-grandchildren's great-grandchildren, as our people would say, the seventh generation, whose faces we can still see coming towards us. Those are my thoughts. Nyawangoa, thank you for listening to my words.